Not too many growers left who grow Phragmipedium. Well, there never were a lot to begin with. But originally, Terry Root from the Orchid Zone in California, Salinas, imported the first Phragmipedium and grew them and sold them wholesale. And that's who we purchased the first batch from back in the early 90s, he started selling them. And they were such a hit because of the intense red color from the Phragmipedium bessii, which is kind of the stepping stone for making any red hybrid in Phragmipedium. And then with the recent discovery of Phragmipedium, the largest of all the Phragmipediums, there's a lot of fun new hybrids out there. So I started breeding orchids as a teenager. I was very lucky to get basically a college internship when I was 12 years old. We had a lab tech working at our nursery. And he took me in and taught me how to make formulas and sow seed and do tissue culture. And then I was lucky again when I was about 20 years old. We had a new lab tech come in who had just graduated with a PhD from University of Minnesota. And he wanted to get a green card. He was from Holland. And in order to get a green card, you have to basically, we had to put out an advertisement for a job and find someone better qualified for him. And if you don't, he gets to get the job and get his green card. And so that's what happened. So it was fun. And so he and I would go to the University of Minnesota, and we would do research on formulas and techniques. And so over the years, we kind of got these cool techniques how to develop orchids, and Phragmipedium has always been a big one. So I think they're fantastic flowers. I think the plants are fun because they can flower twice a year, sometimes even more, so they flower more often than most halves. And a lot of them are successive bloomers, so they'll bloom one after the next on the same stem. And they're a little different in the halves in that when the flower looks fresh, it just falls off. So you think, oh, what have I done? That's the normal cycle. They usually last about 3 weeks. Your conditions are really cool. I've seen them last 4 or 5 weeks sometimes. Then the short ones can fall off in 2 or 2.5 weeks. But if the big healthy plants, they can flower several times in the same inflorescence. Some of the hybrids I've seen flower for up to 1 year straight or longer now. So it's pretty neat. And there's one species that can actually flower that long. I'll show you. I'll start out showing you the nursery. This is an aerial shot. We're in a suburb outside of Minneapolis called Plymouth. It's probably about a 25-minute drive from the airport. And this is what it's like for us in the winter. Actually, this is a terrible picture. This winter, you wouldn't even see the greenhouses. They're just covered in snow. We had a lot of snowfall, some of the most in over 20 years.
He said they had 100 inches.
Oh, felt like it. I don't know how much it was exactly. I know we had 40-some inches in 1 month alone. So that could have been.
What part of Minnesota?
Plymouth. So it's just a northwest suburb of Minneapolis. We grow a lot of different stuff. So this is one of the houses that has a lot of cattleyas. This is a sea of cattleya Warzwickii. We also grow a lot of odd stuff. This is the Morven Falls titanum. So quartz flower. If you follow our website or our social media stuff, I posted some this year. We flowered two at the same time this year. This is a cool flower because this plant takes about 10 to 15 years before it's first blooming. Mm-hmm. And then after that, it only reblooms every 3 years. And it's one night every 3 years. So it's a big deal when you bloom. This was the development of the flower. That's what it looks like when it's open.
Does it say feed me?
It says that to the flies. It says pollinate me to the flies. Smells like dead meat, so it attracts lots of flies to come and pollinate it. So it's just a fun experience. And if you pollinate it, they get these fruits. And so the ones that are all big and bulgy have fertile seed in them. The ones that aren't are just sterile. So I pollinated both of them this year. One took, one did not take, which proves the theory that you cannot self-pollinate. First of all, it can't self-pollinate no matter what because the first day the female receptors take pollen, but the males aren't putting out pollen, and then the second day the males shoot out pollen, but the females are done. So you have to have pollen on hand already. I stored pollen from 3 years prior, and I selfed it, and it didn't work. So, but I took pollen from that and put on the other one, and that one worked. So it was a good theory to test. And it saved you a year, because if you do get fruit, you offset it another entire year. So I won't see the one bloom that's, that took the seed for probably 4 years.
Is the fruit smelly too?
It's very sweet. It smells good. It's highly toxic. One fruit is enough to kill a human, I read. I did actually try a bite of it before I knew that. But I was safe. I took a very small bite. It tastes good. It tastes kind of like mango. But then I thought I should do some research, and I found out it's highly toxic. So either I'm resistant to it, or I just ate a small enough
fruit.
I'm lucky. Don't do what I did. Don't try that at home. If it's not flowering, it's in the vegetative state or it's dormant. So this is one of my friends standing next to it. So you can see how massive this plant is. I was told by one professor that he thinks this is the tallest one he's seen in captivity. There may be some others in other parts of the world that are taller, but this one is really getting large now. That was probably pushing 30 feet tall, I would think. But yeah, it was just a fun thing we had happen this summer. So, when you look at Phragmipedium breedings, you don't see a lot of complex hybrids of frags like you do with paps. You see many, many generations of paps that have been around and bred with since the 1800s. Frags are really only looked into as far as a breeding crop, starting from the 80s. So they had a much shorter life around the paps. The species in the primaries are the most fertile. When you get complex with frags, most of the crosses are very low yield, like 10 to 20 plants in a cross. That's not commercial material. So you won't see a lot offered of these complex crosses until they make divisions or something like that. So that's why I say they're difficult to grow, to go beyond third generation breeding. A lot of them just become sterile. So I think chromosome counts get really messed up as they get complex and they don't want to breed anymore. Progression is mostly achieved with new species. Line breeding, which is taking one species or hybrid and making it again and again until you get a new shape that you like or color. Remaking old crosses with better parentage. Or the most, I think, important one is converting plants into tetraploids. That's when they have double chromosomes. And when you do that, you get bigger, showier flowers, you get more color, more substance, and they, a lot of times, they breed better. So it's a great technique to use. This is the first species that really set the mark for Phragmipedium specii. It comes in two color forms, red and yellow. Actually, there's a peachy form, too. It's an interesting flower. So the structure of the flower, and this goes the same, same with paps, is behind the disc here, the staminodial shield, you have a pollen, which is right here on each side. And the fly goes into the pouch, gets stuck, can't fly out, and there's little hairs inside the pouch that it crawls up. And then these slits here are windows to show light to help guide the fly out. And then when it exits one of the two sides, it'll get the pollen stuck on the back of its head. Often in the greenhouse, I'll find houseflies where the exit is with the pollen on their backs. So they get stuck and they die there because American flies are too fat. Not the Southeast Asian or South American. They overeat and they get stuck. But that's how it works. They get stuck on their back, and the second time they fall in, they're going to exit again, and that's when it gets rubbed off on the stigma, which is what takes in the pollen. And the pollen gets sucked through the back here, that's the ovary, and that swells up and becomes the seed pod. This is the phloem, or the yellow form of Bessiae. The story I heard was, I think it was Ecuador, someone had sold the plant to a customer. They came back upset, complaining, I wanted this red flower, and I got a yellow, disappointed. And so they traded out with the Reds. Oh, sorry, here's the red flower. They got the first very rare. The first one sold for thousands of dollars. This is an example of a tetraploid. So this is, they can occur naturally in the wild, naturally in your own hybridizing, or they can be induced with a chemical. That's the easiest way to make them. This was a natural one. It came from a batch of flasks from one of the original batches of Bessia. And so one of my friends who was working for us at the time, this was the 90s, his name was Rob, he grabbed one and he said, "This is the best one I've seen." And I looked at it and said, "Yeah, it really is." And so we named it Rob's Choice. It's been around ever since. Unfortunately, we lost some of the divisions, I don't know, due to poor culture one year, and down to one plant. But this has been my best AI breeder of all the Phragmipedium. It's really short. 10 centimeters across, which is really big for a best AI. And here's a converted yellow tetraploid, best AI extra. So I like to use those for breeding. But I still like using the diploids. The diploids, for whatever reason, are tend to be a little faster growing with frags, or with the Bessia at least, in their hybrids. So primary hybrids are two species crossed together. So here we have Bessia by Sargentianum that makes Memoria de Clemens, which is a fantastic flower for breeding. It's really the most important stepping stone hybrid for breeding nice big reds. And it's a darker red than Bessia. Now the diploid looks very different than the tetraploid in this case. This is a diploid, and here's a tetraploid. You can see how the petals are much wider and flatter, and also tetraploids have a really large staminodial shield. So they're just a showier flower. And here's back to a diploid, Dick Clements. This is when you use a yellow Bessia. But these flowers will never be pure yellow because the Sargentianum, there's no yellow form of that. And so it picks up some of the color from that. Now this is what you call a back cross, when you take a species that was in the hybrid, one of the hybrid parents, and put it back onto one of the original first species. So Bessia Memorial de Clemens makes me, Jason Fischer. Now my father named this orchid after me in 1996. And at the time, the first one I saw was deformed and unattractive. Why would he do this? That sounds just like my father. And luckily after that, a lot of nice ones started to open up. And they got a lot of attention from judges because it's a really bright, vibrant color. And the shape is very nice on these, consistently. So that's why they were getting so many awards. Because usually you make a hybrid of X amount, a small amount that are really good shape are awardable. But this particular cross was very consistent. So that's how it started getting so many awards. And it actually does hold the most FCCs of any orchid hybrid ever, which I believe is 18 right now for this cross. But there is a orchid species with more FCCs than this hybrid. Anyone guess what that could be? It's a path, that's your hint. They call it the king of paths. That has 20-some, I think 27 or so. So I need to get about 10 more FCCs on this flower to say the most FCCs. But it's been fun. It's been fun to have a lot of them award. And this is one that has a great story behind it. I've used it in my lectures for many years. This is a triploid where a Bessia tetraploid is used. So it does look like a really big fat Bessia with really good shape. This one I did not make. This one I have remade them and they turn out very similar to this. But this one, the first one that was made like this was by Terry Root from the Orchid Zone. And I took this picture with him. Boy, this is probably in the year 2000 and I want to say 3 or 4, he had this flowering. And I was at the nursery the day he sold it. He said, "This is my best Jason Fischer ever, and I just sold it." And I said, "How much?" He said, "More than what some of my employees get for a salary the whole year."
Wow. Oh, so my
how
God.
Much was that? $25,000.
Oh, my God.
$25,000. He's retired now, but on his record, this was the most expensive orchid he'd ever sold. I didn't get anything for it but this picture. But he said, here, you can hold it, and let's take a picture together. So that's what we did. You see his beard made a very good background color for the make the flower pop. And then I always say, if you think you'd recognize Terry Root, it's because you've seen Harry Potter. He looks like Harry.
Yeah.
He's clean shaven now, last decade. This is an example of a recent tetraploid award. Just to show you sizes if you're into judging or a student judge or you pay attention to points and numbers. But this got an AM. It's very hard for these to get FCCs now. There's so many FCCs that they really, really ridicule the flower at this point. But this got an AM, 85 points, which is a good score. So NS means natural spread horizontally. That's 10.3 centimeters. That's a pretty good size. Then this dorsal, these are all horizontal. The dorsal is horizontal, 2.2. 3.1 width on the petals, which is fat. Anything 3 centimeters or larger is really big. The sensepal was very big, and then the pouch was almost 3 centimeters. So all those things make it a nice round flower.
If that plant were on this table, show us how tall it would be.
That plant was probably from the pot to the top of the flower, about like that.
Okay.
So a decent size.
Yeah.
So they only look the best on about the third or fourth growth. The second's pretty good. The first, you can never tell how great of a plant you've got. So never judge a Phragmipedium on the first flower. It's not going to be its best performance. There's a close-up shot. I have a very similar hybrid to that called Red Wings, which has the same parental background. It's just different hybrids crossed in different order to get a similar result. So Red Wing is a cross of called Robert C. Sillick, which is a Dick Clements. I think it's Dick Clements by Jason Fischer. But it's one of those crosses, and then back on to Bessie I again. And so it's just a bunch of Bessie I and Sargentiana mixed into the flower. But this one got an AM of 88, which is good, very close to an FCC. I think if the natural spread was 10 or bigger, probably would have got an FCC. So dorsal, petal, that's actually the length of the petal, not the width. Sensible and pouch, all very showy and big.
Do you ever see two blooms on the big ones?
Yes, so most Phragmipedium bloom one flower at a time. Sometimes two open and within a day the first one will drop off. Mm-hmm. But on a lot of these plants, when they get really large, they have been branching at the nodes on the stem. So you get 2-3 branches, you can get 3-4 flowers open at once. I think I've seen 5 or 6 on some Jason Fischer's now. So I've seen some pretty nice branching. These are being grown in, by the way, I'll talk about culture soon too, soup containers, 1-quart soup containers. And often I'll do that with nice big plants that are coming out of a 3 1/4. The next pot I'll do that because I'll just use a solder iron and punch a few holes so it retains a ton of moisture but still drains. And that seems to work really well for these frags. And you can see this Red Wing was made using the Rob's Choice Tetraploid Bessie, and that's what gives it that huge size. A lot of hybrids are interesting in genetic dominance. So April Fool, this is the one on the left is called Cardinal Birchwood, famous old Schlitterjahr hybrid by Bessie. All the red is gone, so that's why it's called April Fool. But this one is really, really nice. Took on the shape of that Rob's Choice Bessie, but then took in the color of the other pair. So those are the fantastic hybrids. And we get a lot of people, collectors, trying to get divisions of this. About every 2-3 years, I make a few divisions and sell pieces of this particular clone. This is one of my favorite species. There's about 3 different varieties of this species, but the largest leaved and largest flowered one is the longifolium variety, Hinc Sienna. And this is a great plant because this species can bloom for up to a year on the same inflorescence, so some of its hybrids can too. And it is the only Phragmipedium that has an albino form. A lot of orchids, genera, especially paths, there's a lot of albino forms of many different species. For frags, it's just one, longifolium album. So That's why you don't see any green hybrids yet. You need to get to the second or third generation until they get green again, because the first generation is always going to be a combination, or the green will be gone. I crossed this with Schlimmia, I'll show you a picture later. I got some that were greenish, but then the rest were all white. White, I think. But Eric Young is a great hybrid. It's a good beginner frag hybrid. This is a Bessii and Longifolium. That's an example of a really good diploid. And this is interesting. This is Bessii Flavum crossed with Longifolium Album. So those two genes don't line up to make pure yellow or pure green, so the red came back. It does have a lot more yellow than the standard Eric Young. So my next thing I want to see is a selfing or a sibling, which so far have failed. It might be a sterile plant. I need to keep trying of this to see if I can get some pure colors going one way or the other. Longifolium by Dell Sandroid. Nicole Tower. I showed this because this is an example of a branching frag. So there's one inflorescence, two branches. And each branch here is holding, these two are holding two flowers and then one down here. So sometimes you can get multiple flowers. It's not a long display, maybe a few days like that, and then one of them will eventually fall off. But it's neat to see. This is an extreme show of difference. So we got a diploid on the left and a tetraploid on the right of Don Wimber. Don Wimber is Eric Young back on a Bessii. Yeah, it's a back cross. And obviously the forearms are much bigger and much showier. But on this particular cross, I had a lot of them turn out with these jagged edges. That came from, there's a famous tetraploid Eric Young called Rocket Fire. It's a good breeder, but it has that characteristic. But then a few of them came out smooth like this. Now this one is a converted one, that in the flask they were converted from diploid to tetraploid by the Eric Young Foundation in Jersey, in Europe. This is a really cool cross. So Cahaba Cherokee Sunset is one of the long-petaled Phragmipedium. I believe it's Papyri crossed onto the tetraploid Bessii. So when you do that, when you make triploids, they will be very different based on which parent was a tetraploid. Whichever parent was a tetraploid, it's like putting that plant on the other plant two times, two generations. So if it were the long-petaled frag, if that was the tetraploid, and the Bessii was a diploid, this wouldn't have been as red, it probably would have had petals more like this. So in this case, it's being forced to look more like a Bessii. Here's another long-petaled cross, like Staminodium, another long-petaled type by Bessii. And of that batch, I had one that turned out like this. Very skinny. It did not have a staminodial shield, which I thought was neat, because this plant here, Extaminodium, does not have a staminodial shield. So some of the offspring were picking up that. Schlimmii species was for a while separated into three different varieties, because new ones are being discovered, but now they're all lumped back. They're all called Schlimmii variety something. It's the only fragrant Phragmipedium there is. It smells a little bit like rose, and its hybrids do too. Here's one of the other forms that has a nice dark red pouch. So the primary Hana pop-up is great. This is on the left is the red Bessii crossed with Schlimmii. On the right, I took a yellow Schlimmii, or a yellow Bessii and Schlimmii. Those are all pink and yellow, and I crossed those together. And about 1 out of 16 were turning out like this, almost pure white, which is a neat goal because you don't see many frags like that. And here's Schlimmii by Longifolium Album, which is called Sedenii. And this one turned out with a little bit of, show up that way, a little bit of yellow-green color to it. But only one so far. The rest of them have all been white. So I had originally thought, cool, I have a green and pink hybrid available, and I marketed it that way. Well, no one's complained to me yet, so maybe some people bought them did have some green ones, but the rest that I believe were all white. This is a very similar cross, Schlimmii by Hartwigii. Hartwigii is a variety of Longifolium. It just has skinnier petals and skinnier foliage. But it's a really It's a remake. It was a lot of old crosses from the late 1800s, early 1900s that were registered. So yeah, actually, Bessie I brought in the popularity of Frank breeding, but there was some other Frank species that were bred in the earlier days, and I believe the Dorotum was like 1920 or 30. And so a lot of the old crosses, I can't find any pictures of or data on. I'll remake them just to see what they were like. And then of course, Cavaquiae, the largest of all the Phragmipedium, discovered in Peru in the year 2000, I believe. It's a fairly new introduction. It's odd that something so big and showy took so long for someone to recognize. It's a very difficult species to grow. Once you get too close to maturity, they're easy, but as a seedling, they're very easy to kill. So I tend not to like to offer them for sale until I get them to be larger. But they're big, showy flowers. They typically bloom for me between November and March.
What about its hybrids?
The hybrids are very easy to grow. They seem to grow like all the other friends. No problem with those. Just the species takes a while to get up to speed. That was the first one we had of Orchid, called Muy Bamba. We got an AM. And then this one has an AM only because I've never shown it on a really large flower. The year we showed it, the plant was a little stressed and smaller, so the flower was smaller. But this flower is fantastic. It's very, very round. It's everything you want in this species. What you notice on them is you get these tiny little color breaks, or I call them stretch marks. Which is really true because as the plant grows and grows and grows, the flower does when it opens. And actually these plants, I've noticed the flower kind of peaks after about 10 days or so. But the best day to show it would be the third day they're open. So the first day they look interesting, the second day they start to look greeny, the third day they're big and round and really colorful. But then by the fourth day they start to curve and turn. And this particular one stays very flat. Great. Here it is from the side, here it is from the back. And I think because of the wide sinistical below, that helps hold the petals forward a lot as well as the smaller ones when they curve back at the base there. And here it is open several days later, still fairly flat for a Cavaquia. They're pretty neat from above. They've got this neat bright yellow band in the center of the pouch, and they're purple polka dots inside the pouch. Mm-hmm. This is the first FCC we got, called Ray Rob, and it's a beautiful flower. It's a very vigorous plant, so I tried to use this in breeding other Cavaquiae, hoping to get faster growing ones, still growing slow. So I gotta keep trying until I find the right cross that makes them grow with more vigor. But you can see here the multiple growth plant, really happy plant. The original flasks from Peru, my father and his friend Chuck Acker from Wisconsin, they flew to Peru, actually, to Peru, Florida, to buy flasks and hand carry them back. And Glenn Decker in New York did the same thing. So there's another company offering plants to him. And so about the same time, three vendors brought them into the U.S., but none of us sold them until about 7 years or later or so, because they take so long to grow. They typically take about 7 to 10 years before the first flower. So they're just as slow as like a Phragmipedium or a Papyphetalum Rothschildianum or Sandrianum. They take a long time. So there's currently some new techniques for trying that make a lot of the frags grow faster, which I'll show you as well. So right now there's about over 30 registered hybrids of Cavaquiae. It's probably more like 40 now, I would say. Here's a primary. Cavaquiae schlimii. So this one carries the fragrance of schlimii. It does have a slight scent of rose. And it's one of the smaller hybrids because schlimii is very tiny. But still, the flower is 10 centimeters, which is pretty impressive for a frag if you're used to Bessiae and its hybrids. This is a fantastic cross, schlimii, or Cavaquiae and Bessiae, Fritz Schomburg. Still one of the most popular crosses. They're very consistently round. The diploids are pink, but the triploids, where I use the tetraploid Bessiae, are just fantastic. You see some pictures of those too. This was a triploid made by South Carolina's A H.P. Norton. So he did a triple cross, and they're a little more peachy, but ours turned out really, really dark. This is a diploid as well. But here you see a comparison of, we've got triploid, diploid, and then this is made with the yellow SCI, which turns them light pink. But this is an example of how the first bloom is not the showiest bloom. So here's the cross I always wanted to make. It's the Bessie I Rob's choice with our best Gravachia, the Tesoro Morado. It was a big flower, first time bloom, but it's not that great of a shape. So here's on a second growth. This is getting a little better. So is this one. But here's on a third growth. Now this flower is really looking like something. And this is like my ultimate goal in the frag breed, getting something to look like this. And this particular cross has been so consistent. I believe everyone we've put out has got an award, usually HCC or AM. The reason they're not getting FCC is just the way the judging system works. It's because it's a tetraploid Bessie, it's shrinking the size a little bit this way. Petals are wider. Overall, it's a nice round, much rounder flower. The diploids are wider this way, and those scores give them the higher points. But actually, these are a better shaped flower. Yeah, they're beautiful plants. This one was 11 and a quarter centimeters across, and the petals were 4.2 centimeters wide, so it's a very big flower. Here's another one growing in one of those soup containers. Same thing, really big flower size. This is 11 and a half centimeters across. And so this one here is a similar cross, but it was made with tetraploid flavum bestiae. So it's got a lot of peach and yellow in it. St. Olin is a Schlumia hybrid on the left there. It's a Hana Pop-Off back onto Bessiae. And by Kavake, it's Haley Decker, named after Glenn Decker's daughter. And Suzanne Decker is Cape Sunset on the left across from Kavake. So what you notice in a lot of these hybrids is the flowers look like the non-Kavakia parent, but blown up really large. Kavakia has very little dominance on any traits except its size. So you lose the color, you lose the round shape often. Here's a really big Suzanne Decker that I grew. Once it's rooted in well, I can stand a lot of them in water because there's such water demand in plants. But this, the leaf span on this actually reached about 5 or 6 feet across. It was humongous. And when it gets that big, it can hold many flowers at once. I brought a few of these for sale today. Actually, the ones I brought, I think, are going to turn out nicer than this one because I used really large flower parents on them. But Loving Pain is the Memoria de Clemens by Kavakia. I think this could be used, because it looks like a large de Clemens, I think this would be really exciting to see a tetraploid Bessie I crossed onto. That's going to give you something of really good shape and color.
Sorry.
Oh, that's not me. That's you. So if you cross Jason Fischer and Kavakia, you get Glenn Decker. And they're all kind of pink. I've seen some that are more of a fuchsia. None of them are red. But it's a nice cross. Good shape, good color. And then the classic Cardinal cross on the Kavakia is a Josephine. Apart, which is very beautiful. I made this as a stepping stone damselfly. So Kyperum is like a small Sargentianum or Lindleyanum plant can bloom at this size. Sargentianums get really large. So nice big flowers. Hopefully this will breed and give me stuff that are small foliage with bigger flowers. That's always a goal of mine. That's a good marketable product. Incan Treasure is interesting because it's a very good parent. You see second generation hybrids with this. But here we've got Longifolium and Kavakia. Gives you Incan Treasure. So now into the second generation stuff. This one we made called Emmaloman, named after my great grandmother, Fritz Schomburg, on the Fischerite. And I think it's you a really nice It's very small. So the second generation crosses, if the new parent doesn't have Quagga in it, it loses all the dominance and size and it goes back to a small flower. Which is very interesting given how big these flowers are. So here it is next to a Vessii in both these cases. But yeah, they're no bigger width-wise. They have wider petals and bigger pouches and dorsals, but the flowers are quite small. 7/8 centimeters is pretty normal. This one I thought was pretty cool. This is Halodecker by Dick Clements, which is known for making really red crosses. And here you can see how dark they turn out. That's why I call it black cherry. That's a Jason Fischer next to it. Jason Fischer is still bigger, but this plant got a darker, deeper shade of red. But the size and the shape, you know, isn't as impressive. So I always like back crosses. So here we have Halodecker back under Quebecia. This is when you can get something large again and round. But these are first flowering plants, not as big as they probably could be. This one turned out really large. And I was really impressed with it, so I called it Frag Apollo Perfection. Apollo is actually Fritz Schomburg crossed back onto Vessii. Yeah, look at that. That's really impressive. So Halodecker onto Quebecii is Papa Frank Quintal. So here's a first time bloom on that, but here it is compared to Quebecii, obviously not as large. But that was still early opening stage, it opened more. And here it is fully open compared to both of its parents. So still a little smaller than Quebecii, but it is about the same size as the Halodecker, which is nice. And it probably can get bigger the next one or two times it flowers. But my goal is to get something bigger than Quebecii. I think that would be fun. So the only way you can do that is by back crossing in tetrapoid conversion. So a lot of playing around, but I think it can happen. Halodecker back on the Vessii, or on the Vessii is Kyle Quintal, which is cool. It's like a really fat, big Vessii. Lower Lay Quintal, but Quintal, you see that name a lot, as a orchid nursery in Hawaii called Quintal Farms, and they're very good at growing frags. And besides ourselves, they're one of the only places really breeding many frags right now. So Halodecker by Del Sandroy, very dark red. But again, looks like a Vessii. Robert Gagnonet is my retired lab tech. So he wanted something named after him when he retired. So he chose this cross. Fritz Schomburg back on the Vessii. It's a double back cross. So now it looks more like a Vessii, but it's very round. But if you make it with the yellow Vessii, it was kind of neat. It was a small flower, but a very nice, pure yellow. Tiny, tiny bit of pink on the edge of the petal there. Very similar to this cross. So this is neat breeding because both of these parents are pink and yellow. But when you cross them together, all the pink cancels out and you get pure yellow. So I was impressed with that. And I didn't show you the species earlier, but Fischeri was originally imported as Schlimii, and then my father sent in a sample to the taxonomist Guido Brehm in Germany, and then he said this is a new species, and that's how it got named Fischeri. But it's a good parent for breeding. It has a couple features just like Quebecii. It's non-stoloniferous. A lot of Vessii and other species will kind of jump out of the pot on these stolons. These stay in the pot, and the growths come out right next to them, which is nice. It's got deep purple flowers, and it self-pollinates itself, so does Quebecii. So if you don't take the pollen off right when they open, they will self-pollinate. So you should take it off right away to give the plant more energy and to let the flowers be used for other type of breeding. This is Bubbleberry, Fischeri by Emilia Arias. So here you can see it compared to a Schlimii. It's quite large. And very similar result, Halodecker by Fischeri. So going back to the Incan Treasure, you cross it with Jason Fischer, you get Jason's Treasure. which is has less downswept petals, and they're really big and showy flowers. They're probably 12, 13 centimeters across. And this is a new hybrid that Quintal Farms has made, Quintal Elena Alla, which is Contifera, which is one of the long petal twisted petal hybrids by the Treasure. And then this one I made, this is one of the hybrids I made where I predicted what the flower would look like based on the parents, and I was right. So if you know Frank Don Wimber, that is what this looks like, but this is much, much larger. And when my father saw it for the first time, he said, "I'm naming this after myself." So no, you're not. I made the cross. I can choose what I get to name. And they said, "Oh, well, will you name it after me?" And I said, "Well, yeah, you named a pretty nice one after me, so it's a deal." Okay. So I got the name Jerry Lee Fischer. It's a fantastic flower. Here it is next to Incan Treasure. And this, the flower, Jerry Lee Fischer, is going to make it into a National Geographic book that's being published on man-made hybrids, about all flowers in general. But I was at a show in Santa Barbara, and I brought one of these, and it got several awards. And this photographer was taking pictures, and he was asking questions about it, and he told me, he said, "Well, I'm going to use this in my new book." I said, "Well, who do you work for?" I said, "National Geographic." "Wow, that's kind of a big deal." And he said it was a 10-year project. This was like 8 years ago, I believe. So he's probably almost done with the project. But it's supposed to be 10 years of photography of man-made hybrids of any type of flower, and they're going to put a book together. So it's cool that I was able to contact, make a connection with him, and get this in his book. Hopefully, it hasn't been published yet, but he said it was going to be in the book. So then you have the caudatum complex, which are the very long petaled Phragmipedium. For cultural tips, they grow less wet than the other frags, and I'll talk about growing those as well. For smaller plants to grow well in sphagnum moss, but typically I don't recommend sphagnum for Phragmipedium. They tolerate higher heat and light levels than the other frags. And then the species classification causes confusion because different groups of taxonomists label them differently. This is the temperature ranges that I do really well with. So even though they can take the heat, this is typically my average summer temps in Minnesota. 75 to 85 for the day, 65 to 70 at night, give or take a few degrees. And in the winter, it's just a bit cooler. And based on the sun as well, if we get a full sunny day, we can control the heat with the vents. We can get up to 80 to 90 degrees in the greenhouse, even if it's 0 degrees outside, yeah. If the sun is cold. But once the sun goes down, freezing cold again. The nights, I keep it in the high 50s, low 60s. Average light conditions for seedlings, they can be pretty shady. 300 foot candles is very dark, almost like where I'm standing right now almost. We can get them to grow in very low light conditions, and I think they do even better. They stay much darker green. And then you slowly move them in light, brighter conditions as they get larger and more mature. So when they're mature, they grow 800 to 1500 foot candles for us. They've been found in the wild much higher lights of level. But those levels are only for 1 or 2 hours out of the day because the sun rises and sets and they don't have that consistently all day. Orswitzianum, it was originally called Wallisii. Most people still know this by Wallisii. Fantastic plant. This one here had 5 flowers on each inflorescence. I've never seen more than that in my entire life on this species. So I try to use that one for breeding. The caudatum is one of the largest flowered ones. It has a really big pouch, really big dorsal. This big hood here, well, it's the same function for dorsals on slippers in general. It keeps water out of the pouch. So when it rains, the water rolls off the edge because you don't want the pouch to fill up, the flower will rot, and then the fly will drown and won't be able to pollinate the flower. Pandeniae is basically a Orswitzianum without a pouch. The pouch is turned into a long petal. And Pfaffii, or Humboldtii, I believe it's now registered as, is the darkest flower of them all. I like this one a lot because it's also a smaller plant, but gets the same size flowers as Cardano. And on a really good year, this is Robert Young, Canadian, who used to work for us, they can get very long. This one was just over 3 feet long in the petal length. It was about 37 inches. The next Staminodium is basically the same flower with wider shoulder petals and no Staminodium shield. That actually carries over in breeding. So some hybrids, Alien Syndrome, Clachianum hypophaga. Clachianum is a very cool little species. And it made a plant that basically was compact and had the same shape as Clachianum but enhanced features. Stairway to Heaven is a hypophaga and Borswitzianum, which I registered. It makes a great plant. It grows faster and better than both parents. But funny enough, this is a close-up of it. This is a close-up of Cadatum. It looks almost identical. Makes you wonder if Cadatum is maybe an old natural hybrid between those other two parents. I did make a hybrid with this, and I thought it would be very fitting to name it Highway to Hell. So my father registered it, and it got accepted twice. The RHS is never supposed to take more than one registration. So I noted that it had been double registered. And he named it after somebody he knew in England, and I thought, okay, I'll go ahead and have the name. So I have to make another cross and get that name growing again. Mini Grande is Grande by Piercii, which is fun because it makes this compact plant with these nice big flowers. Red Lightning is Sargentianum and Papafia. I would not recommend buying this plant as a seedling. Most of these took 10 years to flower. So only buy this cross maturely, unless you have long-term goals like that. So this is culture light levels for Phragmipedium in general for me. Most of them I go low to medium light. 300 to 1,000 foot candles is sufficient, despite some wild plants being found in full sun in the wild. So lower light, softer, and more elongated leaves. If you're growing in higher light, it's typically for the thicker, shorter leaf types, or when the plants are mature. A lot of times the leaves will adjust to their environment, to what they're getting. They're really easy to grow under lights. It's a great shelf plant. So they don't need high light, but typically the T8 or T5 fluorescence, which you can get standard or LED retrofit bulbs, work really well, or the flat panel LEDs work really well also. My potting media I use for Phragmipedium, if it's not a long petal type, my favorite mix right now is grow cubes. Rock mold. It's a hydroponic material. You can find it at most hydroponic stores. I use it straight on smaller pots, but in larger pots I'll often add some perlite, growstone, or charcoal for extra drainage so it breathes a little more. But it can be used straight at all stages. It just makes you have to water at different frequencies. Or you can use small orchiata bark. I think kiwi bark would work just fine as well. With perlite, charcoal, and I like to add a little peat moss, like a pro mix to it, because it holds a little more moisture, which is what frags like. A lot of people see frags standing in water, especially if where you grow is hot. You can grow them as long as you keep the root system cooler. So by putting them in a clay pot or standing in water, that helps keep the root system cooler. And I've seen people in Florida grow them that way too. The thing I have against standing in water right away once you repot is it typically will rot a lot of the good roots right away, and then you've got bacterial issues, and then you've got to use hydrogen peroxide or something to clean it up. Or repot it again shortly after they put up new roots. Cut off all the dead ones and keep the new ones. So my solution to not doing that is once you repot it, just water it heavy, water it well for about 3, 4, 5 months, and when you can see a good amount of roots have formed, then stand it in water when it's ready to take in all that extra water, and then you won't get the same rot issues. So for long petal frags, I grow them like paths, medium-sized bark with sponge rock or growstone and charcoal for any of the long funnel paths. And like I was saying, the New Zealand sphagnum moss, you can use it, but it does break down quickly because frags like water, you have to water it often, and it doesn't last longer than a year. So it's higher risk for acidity and rotting roots and getting rot on the leaves. So when you repot, when the potting medium is broken down, you can tell it starts to get mushier or it gets darker in color. It doesn't dry as quickly. Or obviously when bacteria or fungus and mold is present in the medium. Or if you have too much blue-green algae, which is slimy material that robs the plants of breathing, robs the roots of breathing well. Live moss is okay. If you have live moss growing on the top, that means you have good humidity, and it's fine. That's how they grow in the wild. And live moss actually holds and releases nitrogen, so it's a great thing to have on the tops of the pots. If you get the burn back from the tips of the leaves, that often means the potting medium is getting acidic or old. Or if the root system absorbs water faster than you can provide it. That's why you stand in water when you get a lot of roots. For containers, I really like the Rand's air cone pots because they offer a low amount of drainage, which means they hold a lot of water, but they also put a lot of air in because of the cone in the center. That's where you put air to prevent root rot. That's the most common area of root rot, is the center of the pot. And so here you can see one that I had growing an air cone pot. The roots are growing around, it's very happy. I actually also like to use these super cheap Taiwanese phalaenopsis pots for production purposes. You know, if I want to put it in a cheap pot, these pots are usually 5 cents a piece. So it's one of the cheapest containers you can get, and they have a single drain hole in the bottom. That works very well for plants that don't want to dry out quick. So paths, frags, even phalaenopsis seem to like it. But I've had very good luck with that. And then these are the 1-quart soup containers, which I just use a solder iron. You can see here, I melt a couple holes on the sides. I want some air coming inside. And then just a few, a 5 in this case, on the bottom. So it's enough to have it hold a lot of water. And then here's a clear drinking cup. This is another, these are the cheapest pots you can get. Much cheaper than buying a pot. You just have to have a solder iron. And here I've just got 3 drain holes on the bottom, and you can see this thing is doing great. It's totally rebound. And that's an Orchid out of mix. Here we have something that's staying wet, and it has live moss on top, so that's great. It probably got a mixture of live moss and maybe algae in the center here, but if the top is live moss, it's still going to breathe well. And you can see the plant's very happy, very dark green. I don't want to mess with it, I'll leave that alone. Semi-hydro, I should take a close-up. Semi-hydro is basically when you have drain holes on the side of the pot, slightly above the base. That way it will hold water automatically, it'll drain down to that point and give the plant extra moisture. When you do that, you want material that wicks and breathes really well. In this case, that's in all clay balls, or even that rockwool product will breathe pretty well, but it'll stay much more wet than clay balls, so that's something to think about. So the ones where I put holes in the bottom, I just call high water retention pots. And this is a papyrus petal that's doing very well in it too. This is what the Grodan grow cubes look like, the rock hole. The cubes are 1/4 inch, the chunks are 1 inch. I would only use the chunks if they're very large pots or very wet, high humidity environment. Otherwise, I think this is the more universal product. Now, I did not do this intentionally. I pulled this plant out of the pot and the stolon broke. So the entire root system was decapitated. Mm. But these are rescuable plants because along the base of frags are dormant roots that are waiting to be exposed to moisture. And so you just stick them back in the pot. You stick the base back in the pot, in this case with grow chunks. And I had this one semi-hydro, so it holds a lot of water. And this thing grew in less than a year, and an entire new root system flowered just fine. So you can rescue these plants, or it's a quick way to divide them if you have a plant shooting off to the side. The safer thing to do is wrap some moss around the base and develop a few roots and then cut it. So water is the most important thing with Phragmipedium. It's supposed to be very clean, which means low mineral to no mineral. be moist at the roots. They never go dry in the wild. They're seeking water all the time. Only stand in water once a good root system has developed. The more roots they have, the more water they need. You can use powdered limestone to buffer the pH if it's getting low. You know how you test pH is you run water and catch it three times through the pot and then test that water. pH 5.5 to 7 range works fine for pretty much all of them. The difference between the standard and the long petal types are the cut autumn long petal types. If it's an orchiata, I can water about once a week. It's enough. When in sphagnum moss, I let them dry almost completely. And when you rewater them, do not make them sopping wet unless they're super root bound. Just water with a volume amount. If you have a pot with some roots and a 5-inch pot, maybe try half a cup of water. See how that does after 1 week. Don't get it sopping wet every time if it doesn't have a root system to handle it. Same pH. I talked about how to measure it. You're running the cup two or three times, collect the water, use a pH meter or test strips to see where you're at. It's very important though. If plants aren't doing well, sometimes all it is the pH. Frags love fertilizer, and the fertilizer should always have the minerals, calcium, and magnesium in it. They also like time-release fertilizer, so NutriCoat works well. Even the Job's plant spikes have proven to boost the growth of frags for me, on top of my regular fertilizer. So do it frequently, and limit your application with sphagnum moss. Now another technique to use with all orchids actually is foliar feeding, which a lot of people don't think about, but it's simple and it prolongs the life of the potting material because you water with pure water and you foliar feed to give nutrients through the leaves. They're absorbed through the epidermis and stomata of the leaf. So it's best done early in the morning or late in the evening, and you apply it with a fine mist, like a misting bottle. And the stomatas are best apt to take in the fertilizer when it's below 75 degrees, which is why early morning, late evening works best. When you make the foliar feed, it's typically 6 times the strength of what your regular feed would be, so you make a stronger solution and spray the leaves with it. And spray it until they're looking wet. And then the last thing I'll talk about with culture is improving the water performance. This is a cool product that a Minnesota company came up with. It's called O2 Grow. It is primarily sold to the marijuana industry. They want to grow those plants fast and sell those bugs quicker. But it works really well for orchids. We did the testing for them on orchids, and we had an average of a 20% increase in growth. That is a huge number for orchids. That cuts out 3 months of your year of growing, which is a pretty big deal. And it also helps kill off bacteria or fungus that could be in the potting medium. And so what it is it's electrolysis. There's these titanium plates with the electrolysis has separated the oxygen and hydrogen molecule, and you get high parts per million of oxygen in the water, about 14 or so after an hour based on the volume of water in the emitter you use. So an aerostone bubbler, no matter how much you run one of these, the highest level you can get is 8 parts per million. That's the highest you'll find at a waterfall. You just don't get higher than that in nature. But through electrolysis, you can get an extra high level, and somehow the plants are able to utilize that and speed up their metabolism. So, yeah, our test showed 18-20% growth increase in orchids, but other tests that universities did, 32-58% increase in bell peppers. I even read 80% in one article, but it's not cost effective. These units cost so much, you'll never see bell peppers go down in price because they have to go up in price to produce them faster. So it's not profitable to use orchids. 21% of tomatoes and the same benefits in aquatic plants. So basically the smallest unit they sell is a 10-gallon bucket unit, which is $199. But I think it's a good investment. If you're watering, let's say, 2 to 3 times a week, those emitters should last you 5 to 6 years. And you can replace the emitters, and you don't have to replace the transformer. So it's an interesting investment if you have a good collection of plants.